Good morning. We are so thrilled to have you join us again for another installment of our virtual seminar grove. My name is Michael Barr. I'm the education director here at the festival, and we are so grateful to the Cedar City and Brian Head Tourism Bureau that is making these virtual seminars possible. And Brian, we're really excited for the discussion we're going to have today, aren't we?
We are indeed, Michael. Yes. Hi, this is Brian Vaughn, artistic director at the Utah Shakespeare Festival. And yes, Michael, we have two incredible artists here in our midst. Incredibly honored to have both of them here. Many of you know these two gentlemen from their very prolific careers in both television and film, but they also have an incredible history with theater and especially the work of Shakespeare. And so I'm so thrilled and honored that they are both here. We're joined today by Tony Amendola and Armin Shimerman, who are both here in our midst. From Los Angeles. I'll give you a little bit of background. We're going to talk all things Shakespeare, sci-fi, movies, television, but a lot of theater sort of emphasis probably mostly. And both of these guys, I'm such honored to be in front of you. You know, what I love about you is I remember I was so nervous to work with you guys both the first time. Because you have such great careers, and you also you played such hard guys, you know, Tony, drug lords and priests, and Armin, you know, Ferengis, and also vampire principal, like all these things that. But then you're both also just the warmest individuals, and so lovely and nice and great practitioners. So we're really honored to have you. I'll give a little bit of background. Both of you have, you know, come from the classical theater world. I know, Tony, you studied at Temple, got your MFA there. For our audience's sake, I know you've done lots of theater work. You have been a principal on Stargate, and most of our audience probably recognizes you as Geppetto from Once Upon a Time. With the festival, he's done numerous things, and we'll get into that in a second. And Armin went to UCLA. He has been on television, as I said, on Buffy and the Vampire Slayer and Deep Space Nine, playing Quark. But both of them also have this incredible theater career, and they also are very formative in the Los Angeles classical theater scene with Antius Theater Company, which we'll talk about also. But I'm really honored to have you here. Armin was in our season in 2019. So why don't I just lead out by that? If you could just give a little bit of a brief background and your first encounter with the Shakespeare Festival and what you might have done here with us at the Shakespeare Festival. We'll lead out with Tony.
Oh, wow. My first encounter with the festival was in 2015, and it was my first encounter with Utah. I had never set foot in Utah. And I thought, wow, what a great adventure. Sharonat was directing Merchant of Venice. And she asked if I was interested in doing Shylock, which I desperately was. And luckily, you know, the powers that be at the festival were agreeable. And so I got to work on the wonderful Adam stage, and it was just a stupendous sort of experience. Also, I was just coming off a lot of sort of television, and so to go back to recharge to as I call it, sort of make an artistic deposit, you know, was so it was unique. And the other thing, and I don't want to go on too long, the great thing I love about working in festival is, you know, theater is it's interpersonal, so sometimes your feelings get hurt, or you wonder why people don't understand you, or you're frustrated with the play. And my antidote is to drive 25 minutes up to Cedar Breaks and stand in front of this natural wonder and realize your significance in the world. It puts things in perspective. And so I've just loved my time at the festival. So thank you.
That's great. Armin?
I believe my first encounter with the festival was through Tony. Tony had gone to do Merchant of Venice, came back, extolling the virtues of Cedar City, and he made me envious of that, and I thought, oh, I'd like to work there sometime. Fast forward a couple of years, and I had the good fortune to do Christmas Carol with Brian in Las Vegas. I was halfway there, and I found out what a phenomenal director Brian was, and so when Brian called, what was it, last year or the year before, to offer me parts in the 2019 season. I jumped at the opportunity. I had heard from Tony how wonderful it was, including Cedar Breaks. It was a big part of his push. And I knew what a wonderful director Brian was. What I didn't know, what was a great surprise, was the extraordinary amount of talent that was at the festival. Not just the actors, but the designers and the directors and the staff. It was one of the best summers I ever spent. Glorious time. And the quality of work. I've worked around the country in various echelons of work. The quality of work at the USF is extraordinary. The best in the world.
Well, it's so terrific to hear you both say that. And I mean, what's so great is you guys both have played these sort of titan roles also, you know, Tony playing Shylock, obviously, as you mentioned, and playing King Lear for us a couple of years after. Armin, Polonius, and Hamlet, you mentioned we got to work on Christmas Carol together playing Scrooge, and you were incredible. And also Gregory Solomon in The Price in 2019, a terrific performance. And you both had the unique honor of both playing the porter in the Scottish play back to back. In fact, Tony played it in 2010 and then Armin in 2019. So you have a little bit of dueling porters, which I think was kind of fun for our audience.
And you cannot tell us who you prefer. Don't tell us who you prefer.
Both great and, you know, terrific and, you know, such a wacky role in this play. Not really a wacky role, but, you know, a little bit of comic relief and also kind of dark comic relief in the show. But you guys were both terrific and very, very different and both very terrific. You know, in the midst of that, and I think that's one of the cool things about working at the festival is you have these large roles, and in the midst of that are also these supporting roles. And, you know, Tony, I know you played the Archbishop in Henry IV Part II, and loved working on that. Such a pivotal moment in that play, and sort of to have your ability in that role really meant so much to me, because it was this idea, I'm playing King Lear and then I'm also playing the Archbishop, but they kind of have equal value as you as a performer. And same with you, Armin, of playing Polonius and then playing the porter. And what was that like for you inside a rep? I mean, have you both done rep in that regard in previous instances?
Tony, do you want to go first?
Sure. Yeah, you know, actually, you know, right from the beginning, fresh out of school. Luckily, I spent a couple of seasons at Ashland. It was really my first job.
Right.
And I knew, particularly, I knew then and now just how lucky I was to step in to that world. And then, like a couple of seasons at Colorado and like four seasons at Cal Shakes and the Globe, but the Globe wasn't in rep when I was there. At least I wasn't performing in rep. San Diego, yeah. And the great, but you know, really what it is, it's a great levelizer. It levels everyone in the company, and it just makes for a much more cohesive experience. And I think one of the most difficult things in Shakespeare is to sustain a level of talent throughout the entire cast. So you're not doing four, five, six in, and then there's a drop. You really need, at Intius we say carry the play or the tray, you know?
Yeah.
And, that's a rep concept. And so, yeah. And it's lovely. And also it gives you, with these great roles, they're not meant to be performed 8 times a week. I'm sorry. I know we do it. We've all have done it. But I think they're enriched by sort of a couple of, having a couple of nights and then doing it, doing three back to back, having 4 days off. You know, I just think it's useful. And getting a sense of the company is really, really great.
Excuse me. As usual, Tony has said everything that needs to be said. I like Tony, and this is one of the reasons we're such good friends. I think our background is very similar. We have a lot of things that are similar in our lives and in our careers. So like Tony, right out of college, I went to work for rep, and at that time, the Globe Theater in San Diego was doing repertory theater, so I went straight from college to the Globe Theater, where I worked in repertory theater, and watched actors and directors approach rep theater. And I fell in love with rep theater for just the very reasons that Tony's just given. I was lucky enough to go on to do a couple of other Shakespeare festivals, so one in Vermont, and then soon after that, repertory theater at the Guthrie Theater in Minneapolis. But I totally agree with what Tony just said, and I won't go on about this. I think roles need to be put off for a day or two while you regenerate your batteries. And it's great to play Lear on one day and the Porter on the next, so that you can regenerate your batteries and get your mind in a different place, so you're not just always thinking about this one role. And to work in a place again like USF, where the quality of work is great, and so that it all summer long, I went to see productions that were performing while I was performing that I wasn't in, and realized what an astounding amount of good work was being done. And so my batteries got generated not by my own doing small parts or large parts, but also by watching other productions that I had heard about but wasn't aware of. And when I went to see them, I thought, my God, that's terrific. And the other work inspired me to go back to the stage the next day and try even harder.
Well, you know, there's one other thing I just want to mention that's unique, sorry, is the notion of generally you're doing a play and there's the audience, the actor, and the audience's lives and the actor's lives that constantly are coming in. And somehow the notion of doing it at festivals at Utah is, it's like a special place. It's oddly, so it's more like a Greek experience where people would travel to come and see plays. And you're just surrounded by this attention and this notion and this desire to receive. I feel very much in New York or Los Angeles, there's a sense of, there's a leaning back of the audience, and you really have to work hard as actors to pull them in, because it's not intentional, but their days and their problems. And yet when you're at a festival, I feel like the audience is so much more present from the beginning.
Michael, you had a question.
Yeah, I want to know, and it kind of ties into what you were just talking about. I know Shakespeare has been foundational in both of your lives, and your careers. Can you tell us a little bit about what it is about Shakespeare that makes it so foundational, why it's so important to be the grounding of an actor, number one? And number two, if you can lump this in two, how did that occur in your own career? When did you first find Shakespeare, and how did he ground you? Through that, if you can take both of those, and whoever wants to start, or if you want to just have a conversation about that,
you go ahead, Armin.
Okay, sure. So I was lucky enough to find Shakespeare in high school. I didn't have any desire to be an actor in high school, but I got cast as Claudius in Hamlet. And so to answer your question, Michael, what I discovered even back in high school, and has been true ever since, is that what Shakespeare does, because what he does so phenomenally well, is his use of language. Language is an extraordinary, magical thing. And when you have a playwright that puts words together and puts ideas and arguments together in such a glorious fashion, it is a privilege and a challenge and a delicious delight to speak those words in such a way that you are communicating to a modern audience what was written 400 years ago. So that to me was what inspired me back in high school. I went on to do it in college, and as I said, went on to do it after college as well. How did it affect my career? I have been reading something about Shakespeare, I would imagine, every day of my life since college. I don't think a day goes by that I don't read something that has to do either with Shakespeare or the period, or the other people that occupied that period with him. So my big television, perhaps breakthrough, was on Star Trek. And even there, it's the use of language. The great writers in television or film or anywhere else use language expertly. The theater's bastion is language. We get visual products and images primarily from film and TV because they can do it better than the theater. We do our best in the theater, but we can't compete with those mediums. But what the other mediums can't compete with theater is language. And Shakespeare teaches us that, inspires us with that. And when an audience comes and leaves, that they've been inundated by great language, great ideas, great arguments. Shakespeare, for me, is both as an actor, as a teacher, and as a novelist. just to tout, I have a book coming out in November that I've written, that one of the major characters is Shakespeare, takes place in Elizabethan times. So there, as I said, not a day goes by that I haven't done something to do with that playwright.
Cool. Tony?
Very, very similar to Armin in the sense that I had, acting was not on my radar at all. Very, very blue collar family. It was, going to the theater, et cetera. And I have to relate a funny story of what a difference a year makes. In my senior year, a friend and I, and it was a high school trip, we went to see, it was Othello with Olivier and Frank Finlay. And, at a movie theater. This is at a movie, and it was a school project. And we looked at each other, about an hour in and said, And we both got up and did what teenagers do. A year later, I stumbled into an audition for The Tempest. Mm-hmm. And that's where it all began. But let me finish.
Who did you play?
I'll get to that.
You'll get there.
Yeah, I'll get to that. So, but let me finish the Othello story. To this day, when an audience decides to get up and leave in the middle of a show I'm in, I flash back to two teenage kids walking away from Olivier and Frank Finlay, and then having played Iago two times, I just shakes my head. Well, a year later, as I say, I stumble into an audition for Tempest. I played the Mariner, first mm-hmm. Mariner. To this day, the first line I ever said on stage, and it served me, for over 40 years. I think about it in LA. My line was, "All is lost to prayers, all is lost." And in the middle of frustration and anxiety and worry, that humorous part of me in the back of my mind says, "All is lost to prayers, all is lost." You got to realize it was during the storm, so no one could even see me. But what a difference a year made. And because of that, oddly, I was too stupid and inexperienced to be frightened by Shakespeare. Mm-hmm. It was the first thing I ever said. And often I would, with the old Olivier thing, I would plow ahead and let the truth catch up with me if it dared. I just sort of barreled my way through. And one thing led to another. The school had a lot of... it was a teacher's college. This was undergraduate school. So they needed men, and I was given great opportunities there. But Shakespeare has always been there, just like Armin. And I guess for me, it's the human condition. If you're looking for a wide range of experience, if the primary question of the theater or of an actor is, what is it like to be you? Then who better than Shakespeare? And it's also so engaging for the actor. When I teach, I make a distinction between teaching Shakespeare and teaching acting through Shakespeare. Those are slightly different things. And you teach acting through Shakespeare because, again, of the scope and the demands emotionally, language, etc. And just like Armin, I think it changes your persona. Sometimes to be honest, in LA, you have to hide your theater background. If you lead with your theater background, they immediately begin worrying as if you can't control the dial to take it within this other medium. But they were, he's probably too theatrical Yet, again, it's foundational in terms of the use of language. If you're going to do a lawyer's sort of summation, my God, how right. wonderful have that background, et cetera. And it goes obviously into sci-fi speak and technical language. So again, but for me, it sort of entered my body, and it never ends. It never ends. You started thinking, the theater he was writing for was generational. You literally could be in the same company and go from Romeo to Benvolio to Mercutio to Laertes to Hamlet to Shylock to Claudius to Lear, you know, and so you could grow up, you could have a life in these plays. So I hopefully look to the future. Luckily, Armin and I, you know, we can play the same role. So
I did want to ask you that. I mean, that, you know, obviously that goes without question. Both of you have crossed over into this, other form, another genre, which I'll classify as the sci-fi world, which in many ways is very similar to Shakespeare. I mean, they're stories. They're also about possibility. And inside that is obviously a great deal of rhetoric that is, you know, specific for that world that you guys are inside of. And I mean, both of you have been on two sci-fi shows that have been very, very like pillars of that genre, really. And what was that like for you? I mean, did that, the background in Shakespeare really influence you when you were folding yourself into this world that's full of characters and story and also deep psychological and
humanic
depth and humanity? I mean, they are.
What
was that like for you as going into that? Because I think that can scare some people. And I do know that a lot of, you know, I've seen a lot of classical actors who have also folded over into that genre. And I think it might be because of this other depth of character and everything that comes from that. And what was that like for you?
If I may, Tony, it's absolutely true. One of the reasons that you didn't mention that is a crossover as well is that Shakespeare's plots and characters are dealing with kingdoms, gods, and major themes. Sci-fi does that as well. Sci-fi deals with, you know, saving the world or saving humanity or whatever. Those are large themes. And one of the things that doing Shakespeare, performing in Shakespeare teaches you is how to approach those large themes. And that's why primarily when you look at sci-fi projects, you're looking at actors who have had classical background, because there's something about approaching the size of that intention, the size of that problem that a classical actor has. I know in my franchise, most of the major actors on whether it was my show or all the other Star Trek shows, all of us, for the most part, are classical trained actors. And what Tony said is true. We have a facility with language as well. We have an ability to look at that technobabble, as we used to call it, and make sense of it, not only for ourselves, but for our audiences as well. But there is a larger than life training that you are taught doing classical plays that you can use to matriculate over into sci-fi. And one brief story before I let Tony speak. If people go back and see my second, perhaps my second performance on Star Trek, you'll see that my character, whose name is Letek, is very close to Richard III. He has a hump and he limps. So I stole what I knew from Richard III to put into Star Trek, and that was the beginning of my career there.
Cool. Before Tony answers that question, just want to remind our Facebook listeners and viewers that we will be starting with questions at about 10:40, so in about 15 more minutes. So if you have any questions for Tony and Armin, feel free to post those questions now, and we will give them to them in about 15 minutes. So go ahead, Tony.
You know, it's a great question. It made me think fondly back to, I guess it was the Lear season, when the gentleman whose name escapes me now, he came with the iambic pentameter Star Wars book.
Ian Desher.
Brilliant man. And yeah, that's brilliant. Sort of another example of how wonderful the festival is to have that guy come and do his lecture. But again, it also sort of points out the sort of the sci-fi world and the classical world, the Shakespeare's world, be it the tragedies, the histories, and obviously the romances as well. But I mean, specifically, you know, so often we have 4 weeks in the theater. If we're at the festival, we have 6 weeks because it's in rep, to rehearse and to think. In television, you're given a role and you do one audition and now you're on set and you're wondering, what did they really want? Who is this person? So, you know, I remember specifically on Stargate, I went in for Master Braytak, trying to work with the costumer and, you know, being the seasoned, trying to be the seasoned, oh yeah, I got this all under control. You know, the actor has to say to the producer, I am the solution to your problem. Meanwhile, the actor's trying to go, what do I do? and you're looking for clues of, you know, how are they going to dress you and everything? And I remember thinking, it took me back to the Roman plays. Braytak has a certain stoic sort of quality within himself. There's something that's very honorable. It's very reasoned. And I thought, oh, I can use that. So he's a sort of Roman samurai stoic. So, and you're just trying, and it serves you so well to have, as Armin said, that sort of reservoir. So, oh, he's like blank blank. So it provides you with the accelerant to begin. Then when you do one episode, five episodes, you're gradually learning about the character, and then you're in the driver's seat. But it's so important to have some frame of reference. Also, I always believe that there's some actors who make more sense in different periods. I've never felt like a modern actor. Probably the closest I've felt to it is if I do urban plays. But even that, if you really know urban people, it's not quite. I can cheat it, but I've always felt like I was of a different century. So the notion of walking on in the 17th century in those clothes never seemed odd to me, unless the occasional costume designer who dressed me like a couch. And we've all had that experience being on Elizabethan stage. Now, I'm not talking about Utah. Being on Elizabethan stage, you realize you're wearing upholstery fabric. You think, what is going on here? So there's something, I think it's invaluable. The psychology is invaluable. I mean, if you look at Coriolanus and that relationship with his mother, if you look at Iago and sort of how we've gone from sort of street fighting to spraying everyone, if you want to, you know, spraying each other with gunfire. If you look at Lear and the anger of a father, the sense of being disposable, an actor can relate to that, whether it's his fault or not. An actor can relate to a modern actor, a modern person. So all of that is there, and it's useful for whether you're playing a dad in Appalachia or whether you're playing Lear. So
I love that. I mean, it's, you know, the actor's toolbox is everything, really. You know, it's like all the stuff you come to the material with, this great foundation of that. And it's really wonderful to hear both of you talk about that, especially for young people, because I do think having that foundation means something. And to hear both of you, who've been so successful in all of those genres, express that the sort of importance of theater work and classical text and rhetoric and language, that informs that other medium, which is visual and, you know, depth of character and subtlety or whatever else. And I mean, how was that when both of you, you know, sort of transitioned over? What I love about both of you also, you're such good friends, and I've heard so many great anecdotal stories from both of you. But when you first crossed over, like the first time you were in front of a camera, was that challenging for you?
I will reiterate what Tony said. It was challenging, and I was too large. My first experience as a recurring character was on a wonderful show called Beauty and the Beast with Ron Perlman.
Yeah.
Almost everybody who was a secondary player on the show had a classical background. And Perlman walked on set in a tremendous amount of makeup and never talked any louder. And we used to laugh at him and say, you know, Ron, we can't hear our cues. But I realized you have to bring it down. You have to bring not just the voice. And if you bring your voice down, the performance comes down as well. So you're not too large for the camera. But it was detrimental in the beginning, that transition, because I was indeed, what Tony mentioned before, I was too large for the camera. And I learned to just bring it down. You can do everything else. Just do it at this level.
Yeah. Wow. Tony?
It's funny. I learned that same lesson actually watching Peter Falk. In Columbo, I did an episode of Columbo. It was maybe my third or fourth job, and I was so excited to to hear Peter Falk, just such an iconic sort of television character, and I couldn't hear a word. I could not hear it, and I realized it sort of points to the difference, I think, if we ever get to that, between the media, television, film, and theater. Theater, the use of voice and the command. The command, being able to attract attention, to demand attention, and to dominate a space, power, is so essential. It's that whole notion of almost like the town crier, if you will. It was it's not the only thing, but it's very, very important. Just the opposite in television and film, I think. In many, many ways, it's about letting them in. It's about letting them in your eyes and trusting the camera. To have the thought as much as possible. It's not, I sit in between in the methody sort of world. Whatever works. I'm in the whatever works world. But it's different. It's very, very, very interesting. And you just learn. I mean, it's hard to watch your performance on film. I don't enjoy it, but I do it because I want to learn and I want to improve. So I do it for that reason. I try not to, look at my hairline or look at, no. It's, am I communicating what I thought? And it's fascinating how sometimes when you least expect it, I had an incident where I had a tragedy, there was a death in my family, and I had to perform, I had to finish the shoot. It was a night shoot and jump on a plane. And you always think, oh my God, that must have been terrible. I was so distracted and everything, but there was something raw within me. There was a need. There was an immediate sort of thing I was going through. I knew I had to get on that plane. And it oddly came through on film, and the audience made the rest of the puzzle and gave it to my character in some fashion. I was going through a completely different thing, but they made sense of it, and it made sense, that emotional state. In the theater, that probably, in the theater, because there's, you have to do one take, you probably are distracted in your lines and you're worried and it might knock you off. But there's a rawness that I feel, it's like a matador, they said, the camera's the bull. And will you flinch? Are you willing to really let the camera in? And it's an interesting sort of mindset when you look at it like that. And that's the hard thing about actually television acting in a kind of way. It's quick and it's ultra demanding. Unless you're playing a talking head. If you're playing a talking head.
You both address that. You've both opened up Pandora's box that could take another 3 hours for us to unpack here. But you both were there for the multiple shifts in the medium from stage to film. I'm reminded of the stories about The Godfather, when all of a sudden he brings all these method actors in to do the stories of The Godfather. And, the producers are saying, we can't hear them. And there was this shift to that open rawness of that honesty on film, that method. And both of you have experience training-wise there. You both have lived to see that, both on stage and also in film. And you both experienced that on your own. How did you navigate that different demand for film and television and different from demand to theater? How do you turn that switch on? How do you turn that switch off? And can you comment a little bit on how the industry shifted in that storytelling too? Yes?
Sure. Brian, I think, answered it succinctly. It's a toolbox, he called it, and that's what it is. That you need a wrench, to do theater. You need larger than life. Tony's also suggested it. You command the space. You force them to come, you know, to go out to them and force them to rivet their attention on you and the production in front of you. In TV, it's not a wrench. It's a needle nose pliers, and you learn what works for which medium. What Tony just said, I hope to remember always, which is, the theater is one thing. In TV, you have to be vulnerable. You have to not demand attention. It's just the opposite. You have to allow yourself to be vulnerable and to not ask to be the center of attention. Mm-hmm. And when you do that, and you're part of the ensemble, and you blend into what's happening, that's when the performances are really good. Otherwise, when you watch yourself, you say, that's too large, that's too big, that didn't work. I wasn't listening. The trick to television acting for me is to listen. Mm-hmm. If you can listen, first of all, to the actors that are speaking, you actually hear what they're saying, that's essential. And then Tony's touched upon it. And if you can hear yourself think while you're performing and react to what you're thinking, that also makes for deeper, richer performances.
Right. Yeah.
Cool.
You know, that's absolutely true. There's something, you know, the actor is always dealing with trying to create a kind of tension. And in the theater, it always is. I remember something Olivier said, you know, because Olivier came in, as much as we think of him as a master of text, he was constantly criticized for butchering the text by the previous generation, by the Gielgud's, that style. And so the actor is always looking, I think, for a kind of tension. If it's in Shakespeare, it's between text and behavior. Mm-hmm. How much behavior can you put into that formal a play and with the demands of rhetoric? And the same thing exists, oddly, in television and film. If it's a very, very small project, then what becomes important are when you can pop it. When will it sustain a pop? You know, it's the old saying of, you know, comedy is actually much more important in tragedy, mm-hmm. in the sense of getting a laugh, a release for the audience. And the other thing, lest we forget, as actors, we're responsive to the tastes of the playwright and the director. If in fact we're going to work, if it's going to be a collaboration, we have to have, the, you know, Brian's term, that toolbox that can adjust our truth to meet the demands of this particular production of Lear or Henry IV Part II or whatever, you know, in the room at that time with these actors. And it makes for a much more collaborative and pleasant experience if you can do that. If you insist on giving the performance that you created in your home, in the study, and ignoring everyone who's in the room with you, who may be doing things you don't like, mind you, it's doomed in a kind of way. So television is, you know, one of the first jobs I got, this is a quick story, when I got to LA, is I got a job in a show called Tamara, which was the grandfather of the environmental things, about an Italian poet, freedom fighter named Gabriele D'Annunzio. And this was a play where everyone followed everyone, which meant that the audience can be 20 feet from you or 18 inches from you. And it created a kind of focus. And your blocking existed within a loose framework because the audience might be standing where your blocking was. So I remember that so vividly because it was the greatest camera training. Because in the theater, generally people are paying attention. There's lights, there's focus. You know, I mean, you're doing television and film sometimes. There's about six people moving behind you, said, you know, pulling cable and doing all this stuff. So your concentration is essential. And so they're different. They're both in search of the same thing. They are definitely in the same family, but they're sort of toned down. You need that sort of dial to be able to, and it's an ongoing thing. It's like mixing sound, I think.
That's interesting. Yeah.
And very quickly, well, one other thing that needs to be said as well. One of the great things about USF or any Shakespeare festival, because the theaters are radically different, you have three different theaters where you need different techniques for each of the theaters. So even though you're performing theater in each one of those theaters, you have to be aware of what that theater demands from you, the actor, and accommodate that, whether it's proscenium or whether it's in the round, or whether it's intimate or not so intimate, whether you're in the large Shakespeare festival where you have to project, or in the small theater where you have to be intimate.
Yeah.
I wanted to add, but one of you, I think, mentioned this, or both of you touched on it essentially, but this idea of like the unique individual inside these roles also, which I feel like is what the universality of Shakespeare is. Is so beautiful that it really forms to the individual that is inside it, you know. And I think part of the enduring aspect of the cultivation of this work continuing on is like different voices inside these roles, that it resonates a new level, and it always makes them interesting. You guys, as I mentioned before, and this is a question that somebody had, Kimberly says, what Shakespeare character would you like to play in the future? And if there are other bucket list roles for you, that is a question I want to ask both of you, because you have played Lear and the Fool and Polonius. And I mean, what are the ones that either you want to do or that you also maybe want to revisit? Have you had that?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, Prospero is something I'd like to, you know, having said all is lost to prayers to prayers, I should be able to say, you know, our revel's now ended. So I definitely would love to do that. I'm constantly looking. I just started, this is not within Shakespeare, but I just started working on a play I'd never worked on. It's a great play, The Caretaker. Mm-hmm. You know, Pinter's The Caretaker, but within Shakespeare, and I would definitely like to go back, you know, into Lear. I had a chance to do Iago twice and Leontes twice, mm-hmm. 10 years after, both 10 years in between. And I can't tell you what a difference it makes to have gone through a run of a play and you realize, okay, there's still a solid structure there. And how can I, what if these last 10 years in experience and whatever have taught me that I could bring to this role. And, you know, there's one other thing you mentioned, Brian, about, and this is almost sacrilegious to say this because we're talking about text in Shakespeare, but I would say that the audience comes to hear the subtext of the actors, the designer, and the director in the production as much as they come to hear Shakespeare's language. And what I mean by that is otherwise they could stay home. They could stay home and just read the play. That we do, you know, through your conceptual work, the designer's great work, the Armin's work, the other actors, that we, there's a kind of alchemy, a chemistry between a role and an actor, that's why you can see the same role done by, you know, 15 people and still, you know, really think, I've never saw that before. And the text doesn't change. You know, it might be differently shaped through cuts. And so that's always fascinating to me.
Cool. Yeah. That's great. How about you, Marvin?
I would, if I wanted to revisit a role, I think I would like to certainly revisit York and Richard II, which I was too young to do when I did it at the Taper. But I would love to do that again. There's something fascinating about that role because he is the moderator between these two forces of nature, his two nephews, and working it out so that there's peace in England and still trying to keep his family together. That to me is a fascinating role. I'm much more interested in the supporting roles than I am in the lead roles. The lead roles are very flashy and you take the last bow and that's all very nice. But I'd rather spend the time sculpting the smaller roles into something that, as Tony just said, is memorable. The other thing that Tony's absolutely right about is seeing different actors play the same role. That's fascinating. And as a teacher and as a director of Shakespearean plays, to see what the actors come up with is highly educational and inspirational. To go, I never thought of it that way. Never, ever. And that actor has just come up with something that is astounding. That to me is in many ways much more gratifying than me coming up with the answer. If I can take that performance, either in class or in a production, and shape it after they've given me the inspiration, that is lovely. There are several roles that I'd like to revisit, but they don't come to mind right now. Perhaps Shylock. I've always wanted to play Shylock, and you can understand why. And that to figure out where the through line is to make him a human being, because he wasn't written as a human being. If you look at the way it's written, he's written as really a villain. And yet, because of the change in our cultures, we can't play it that way anymore. So we look for the humanity in Shylock, but we also have to hold on to what's originally there. So to find that narrow path between the two would be an enormous challenge, I think.
I love
there's one other role I want to say that's really, I would disagree with Armin on that those last things, but that's for another discussion. But there's one other play I want to mention.
How dare you, sir? How dare you?
Well, we have to disagree, otherwise we're not human. Occasionally disagree. It's All's Well That Ends Well. There's a character, Lefeu, who really intrigues me. I got a chance to direct the play at Ashland, and what intrigues me about that play is midway through, I realized it's the only comedy where the older people are the wise people in it. The older people are actually correct. Huh. And I mean, comedy is all about youth breaking through the rules and regulations of age and the restrictions. And it's the only one. And so Lefeu has always been one of my favorite characters, more so than Parolis, which is obviously a terrific character. And,
cool. That's great. Michael, did you have a question?
Well, I have a question. I wanted to follow up with Armin's question because I'm always intrigued by what the discussion going on online and what's happening right here. And Armin is just right in line with the questions that are happening here. Ivy asks, have your experiences with teaching changed how you approach a performance? And I think that ties in kind of beautifully to what you were just talking about. So for both of you, I know both of you are master teachers too. So have your experiences with teaching changed how you approach a performance?
Absolutely. Because I steal. one of the great things about teaching is you go, that's good. I'm going to take that if I ever approach that play. I've seen new ways to look at characters because my students have come in and had a different tack. And invariably, I catch myself. I go, well, you know, traditionally, you know what? What I was going to say doesn't count. That's really a very good approach. Forget about tradition, but that's not a bad idea. Yeah. And if it fits all the way through, then you have discovered something comparable to Curie finding radium, you know?
Yeah.
Cool. Tony?
Yeah, you know, there's a big debate about whether in fact acting can be taught. Mm-hmm. Can it be taught? And when I teach, or my belief is that teaching acting is as much about nurturing and gardening as it is about anything else. There are certain things you have to learn to water, you have to learn to use the right soil, and you just hope. Because it's very interesting. You have actors who have none of the rhetorical skills, but will step into Shakespeare and being able to occupy it, and you can guide them through the rhetoric, and you think, wow, oh, yeah, there's something there. And then you have other people who have all of the rhetorical skills, all of it, and they know everything. They have a trochaic foot, you know, a spondee, and you somehow can't get it in their body. You can't have them say, yes, that's the beginning. That's the door that you can find to open where the treasure really is. Right. You know, and so I'm much more patient than I probably was 25 years ago as a teacher. And I'm also, like Armin, stealing and trying to look for the fresh perspective on material that I know. So it's also invaluable to formulate your ideas, because as an actor, your ideas can be all over the place. And you sort of, you know, it's like the whole notion of, you know, acting is like building a house. There's something of being an artisan about it, except sometimes you have to start with the air conditioning that's on the roof. Yeah, you know, it's so I find it's very, very useful. And, you know, I've occasionally, you know, I'll go back to a university and teach and do a play with students. And I find that just really refreshing and invaluable, because I'm forced to articulate what I may know either, you know, emotionally or instinctively. So.
I want to ask, we have a question from Chase, which I think in some ways kind of relates to this a little bit, but do you approach character development differently when you are performing for stage in comparison to film or TV roles?
Well, the good thing about the theater is you know the character development. You know what happens in the first scene and you know what happens in the last scene. So you work out the arc of your character because you're given the materials certainly before the first day of rehearsal. In TV, where you have an ongoing character, you have no idea where this character is going. And in fact, you influence that progression by being the actor that they cast. So you have some input that way. So you have to, it's open-ended for TV. You don't know where it's going. You make choices, and then perhaps the next time you're in that role, they built upon those choices, or they decided not to go that way. But in the theater, you have a context, and there's something wonderful about having structure, which is what the theater gives you, and that you vibrate in that structure. Mm. That's what we're talking about, going at the roles in a different way. You know what's on the page. You know what perhaps has been done before, but you're finding new ways to approach that. In TV, as Tony mentioned before, there's very little time. You bring your choices and you hope that they work. In the theater, you sculpt those choices. You come with choices in the first day of rehearsal, and as we progress through the 4 to 6 weeks of rehearsal, we learn to keep what we think is right and then try new things, always taking care of what you want to do, certainly, but what accommodates the production, what the director wants, what the designers want, what the other actors want.
That's great.
Well, you know, it gets back to also the rep situation. When you're within a company, you have some information about other people. So there's already, when you're working with a group of actors, there's already relationships. It's not as difficult to deepen. In television, the most important person in your life, the person you love or fear or anything, you've just met them 10 minutes ago. Mm-hmm. So you have to, and that's one of the tricks I know, for instance, specifically in Stargate, you know, you do Richard Dean Anderson, there's this. No, there's one character that I care about, and it was a character named Tilk, and he was played by an actor named Chris Judge. So when I arrived on the set, that's who I looked for. Everything, anyone else, was unimportant to me. And it was actually a funny story, because I walked right by Richard Dean Anderson, who was expecting me to sort of, you know, because he's the number one. And I wasn't being rude, but I just went, Chris Judge. And he looked at me, I looked at him, and thought, okay, this is going to be okay. But here's the other deal that can happen. Then I was a regular in the first season of a series called Continuum. And that was unique, as Armin was mentioning, because they gave me the Bible, and the Bible on a television show are all the conceptual things and the arcs of the character. Because I was playing a puppet master, a sort of Lenin-like, ends justify the means, very gray character. It was quite violent. It was the Occupy movement. So he gave me all the information of where we were going. And I thought, boy, this is unique. this is wonderful. I thought, my God, it's like doing plays. This is, oh boy. Except the Simon Barry, who's the creator, and Jeff King, they were the two guys with this. They were smart enough to withhold the last episode when I was killed. So no, they told me I was going to die, but the surprises that I had to face. So if they'd given me the whole thing, then my actor mind would have started them. But they did everything. I didn't know this. And then all of a sudden we got to the last episode and it was like, wait a minute, bang, bang, bang. I didn't know any of this. And they said, yeah, that was intentional. So, you know, whereas a theater actor, we want to feel like, no, we can build the stepping stones. This is a structure. We can hearken back. You know, there's a long tradition of actors only getting sides and not getting the whole script, as we know, you know, from Shakespeare. So it's always interesting of what is related. And if you really want it, we're talking about other media, you do a video game. I've done a couple of video games where I didn't even know what my character was doing. And, you know, they're very secretive in that world. So it's a very strange thing. And again, flexibility is incredible, and a sense of breath, of just taking a deep breath and say, it's going to be fine. You've been doing this for 40 years. And lest you forget, they hired you. You know, there were 1,000 other people they could have hired. My wife, actually, that's my wife's line. She says, why don't you be Tony Amendola today? Oh, okay.
That's such a great thing, I think, for people to hear, though, too, is that, you know, you have both of these esteemed careers and you've been at this for so long that you indeed still get nervous or, you know, be uncertain. And that's a great, I think.
There wasn't one performance of Hamlet that I wasn't a little bit nervous going on with Polonius. You always get those nerves. And, you know, those nerves are good friends. They push you to do a better job. If you're not nervous, then you're blasé. And if you're blasé, you just rip the audience off. They come to see a performance and you don't give one.
Yeah, very healthy for the individual. I do want to touch on, we're running almost out of time, but can you guys give us a little bit of background about NTS, the theater company in LA, the classical theater? I know Tony was an artistic director there for many years. Armin has worked there many times, directed, and is also an educator through there. Your wife, Kitty, is currently the artistic director. Can you just give a little bit of background for people about the foundation of it and the mission? And because I find it fascinating and beautiful, and the work being done there really, really vibrant and wonderful.
Tony, I'll let you start because you were there before. In fact, I belong to NTS because of Tony. Tony is the one who invited me to NTS. So I'll let you start, Tony.
Well, thanks. Armin actually served as an associate artistic director at 1.2. It's sort of interesting because there's a tie in film and theater. It was started by, as a brainchild of Dakin Matthews, who, for people who know theater, is sort of an iconic figure, and Lillian Garrett. And the notion was, there are all these wonderful theater actors in Los Angeles, people who love the theater, and yet they're there to do film and television so they can have sustain themselves economically and also be 21st century performers. So that media is part of our life. To ignore television and film, to me, I think you need to at least get your feet wet a little bit. But anyway, how do you do that? And so they came up with a notion of double casting, because this was a waiver situation, meaning actors were not paid or paid very, very little. And you would tandem on a role. The very image of Antaeus is of, for you Hercules fans, was an earth spirit who Hercules encountered. And he was sort of a hairy little guy, and Hercules thought it would be easy work and would just toss him. And every time he tossed him on the earth, this spirit got stronger. And that is the notion. It's actors who feel like the theater is their source of power. Mm-hmm. And it will always be. It's the primal place for them. And the only way Hercules could kill this spirit was to hold him off the ground and squeeze him. And that's how he killed him. And that's what we feel like as actors, that if we're removed from the theater too long, we will lose our very essence. I mentioned about making an artistic deposit. It's a joke, but it's true. there's this, at a certain point, I feel like I've been living on the interest of a principle that I was gifted in the theater. And so Antaeus, and I won't go on, I'll give it to Armin, is trying to keep that experience and that dream alive with a community of people. And the theater was created, Antaeus Company, and it's grown. It's almost 30 years old now, close to it. You go ahead, Armin.
So Tony's right, those are the roots for the theater. The present condition of the theater is, it was always meant in the beginning anyway, to be classically oriented. They studied classical plays. They focused on abilities, whether it was acting or mask work or other things that you could use in classical work. And for the longest time, it was primarily a study group that occasionally did productions. When we moved from Dakin as the first artistic director to Jeanne Hackett, Jeanne very wisely decided that we should perform more. And we tended to focus again on classically oriented plays, whether they were classical plays or plays that had greatly influenced by language. And we did that for a long period of time. As the theater matriculates, every theater has to reinvent itself. So we are still interested in that focus on language, on classical themes, but now we're also working more and more towards modern plays and mixing the season so that it is both modern plays and classical plays. But Tony's right. For the most part, those of us who belong to Antaeus need that inspiration of the theater that we so adore to continue on to do TV and film. As I'm looking at all the faces here, I would not be here, sitting here in front of you, had I not done television. The only reason Brian and I first met was the powers that be thought, oh, we'll get a TV actor to play Scrooge. And luckily that turned out to be a very nice relationship between me and Brian and everybody else. But if I hadn't done TV, I wouldn't be here. I would never have met Brian. We wouldn't be talking about what we're talking about.
Yeah. We would have met. I know it.
How? You were in Utah. I was in Los Angeles.
I know. I would have found you. I would have hunted you down. Are you kidding me? Our paths would have crossed.
I hope so, Brian. I hope so.
I know.
Well,
go ahead, Michael.
This has been fabulous, and I want to thank you. You are gentlemen and scholars and artists, and this has been a rich hour. So thank you for the generosity of your hearts and spirits for joining us here, but also thank you for the great work that you've given in those seasons. You were equally as generous, both of you, as a teacher. I mean, both of you worked and helped with our classes through here too. It's just, thank you for making the deposits. But I think
if we don't teach the next generation, then how will they learn? How will our? I mean, we all stand on the shoulders of the people who came before us. Right. Every generation of actors, whether they like the previous generation or not, they stand upon the shoulders of the work that was done before. We need, as performers and as teachers/performers, we need to instruct that generation in what we've just experienced, listening to Tony and Brian talk about their experiences and pass that on to the next so that they can go further because they don't have to reinvent the wheel. We've invented the wheel. And now they go further. That's what's essential. It's essential to perform and to instruct.
Cool. Well, thank you. Thank you very, very, very much. Quick closure here. We want to thank Cedar City and Brian Head Tourism Bureau for making these possible and invite all of you to come down. You can go up and stand at that canyon. You can stand right at that canyon and be inspired by the same thing that they were inspired by as well. We would love to have you come join us during that. Restaurants are open. We'd love to have you join us this. Also, listeners and viewers, feel free to share and like these on Facebook. That helps us. We want these great discussions to be shared all over until we can meet again. So feel free to subscribe to our YouTube page. These will be recorded and listed right down at the bottom of our virtual festivals page at bard.org. And you can watch all of these. And I know there are teachers that are doing that. Thank you so much. We appreciate your gifts to us. And
Michael, you want to plug our seminar tomorrow too?
Oh, yes, absolutely. We have an incredible seminar tomorrow. Jeff Leader will be joining us with two of those great costume designers, and they're going to be talking about the art of costume design. We're really looking forward to that. And then next week on Thursday, we'll be joined by Patrick Page, and then sound design on the Friday after that. So we've got a great array of really, really great virtual conversations. And I really think this, we're at 1107, we're doing fine here, right? You should have heard them talk about the life of the theater after. In fact, let's close with that. Just a real brief thing. Will we breathe again after this, Armin and Tony? Will we breathe again? What will happen?
I hope that we'll breathe again. I'm not so sure that I think theater will be the last thing that comes online. As I said earlier, I don't know how comfortable people will feel with sitting next to strangers after COVID and not knowing who that person is next to them that's laughing and guffawing all over them as the actors spit at them from the stage. I don't know how quickly we'll feel comfortable with that again. I sure know that if it were to disappear, life as we know it would be a much poorer place without theater.
Cool, great. And Tony?
It will come back. People have to tell each other stories. And theater are just important stories.
Great. And being in the same room with the storytellers is what's essential.
Yes.
Yes. Well, thank you so much. We appreciate your help. Thank you, Richard, for taking us out. Thank you, Tanya, for being online.
And I want to just extend my thanks to both of you also. I would look for every opportunity to collaborate with you anytime because you're such incredible human beings and artists, and I'm incredibly grateful for you taking the hour here. I think it's really informative, and especially for those journey people, actors, these new people coming to the theater and teaching young people about the importance of the craft, but also that the possibility to cross over and have very valuable careers with this influencing them, I think is really, really vital. And I'm just really grateful. You guys are such great guys. It's great to see your faces. And thank you so much for taking the time and your support of the Utah Shakespeare Festival. It's really fabulous.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, Brian. It's our pleasure.
Yeah.
Well done. Thank you so much, and God bless.